Hello and welcome back to another Prompt Muse tutorial. If you want to learn how to make animations like this and also add loras to your prompts, which will give you a consistent theme, style or character, then this is the Warp Fusion tutorial for you. You're going to have at least Google Collab Pro, if not Google Collab Pro Plus. And yes, you can run Warp Fusion locally on your machine. However, it's going to take all your processing power. You're not going to be able to use your computer whilst you are Warp Fusioning. I suggest following this tutorial and doing it remotely using Google Collab. So Warp Fusion does not run on automatic 1111. It currently only runs via Google Collab Notebook. The only place you can get this notebook to run Warp Fusion is from Alex's Patreon page. The link is here and in the description. Once you have subscribed to Alex's Patreon, you will find that the Warp Fusion notebooks become unlocked so you can actually download. In this tutorial, I'm going to be using the latest development, which is 15. Just a word of caution, these are nightly builds, so this means there might be bugs and issues with them. However, I've been using this particular notebook for a few hours and there seems to be no issue whatsoever. And to be honest, I think it's the best build so far. If you are having problems, head over to their Discord here and Kytra and Alex will be more than happy to help you. They are awesome. To load this notebook into your Google Collab, just click it and it will download it locally to your computer. Fire up Google Collab. The link is in the description. Go to File, Upload Notebook, Browse, and then find that Warp Fusion version that you had downloaded, and our notebook is ready to play. What you need to do is first ensure that you're signed in, and then on the connect button underneath, if you press the down arrow, you need to connect to hosted runtime if you're using Google Collab Pro. So click that, because that will ensure that we're using our compute unit and the GPU. Right, so the first thing we're going to do is head down the notebook until we get to cell number one, which is setup. We're just going to run this cell by clicking on this play button. This is going to ask you for permission to connect to your Google Drive. Please do so, and we'll come down and click on allow. Once you successfully ran that cell, you will get a green tick. So it's time to move down to cell number two, which is settings. Under basic settings, you have your batch name. So this is the name of the folder it's going to create in your Google Drive where it's going to be putting all your output files. So I'm just simply going to call mine tutorial 01, and then we come down to width and height. So this is very important. So this is the width and the height of your output video, so you want to match this with your input video, and 720 by 1280 is a great starting point. Just make sure that your input video matches this resolution. Now, if you go lower than this, you might have issues with ControlNet. The lower the resolution, the harder it's going to be for the AI to create a consistent and coherent animation. So I'm going to be creating an animation which is going to be 512 by 768, just because it's going to take a long time to render if I do it at any other resolution. So simply change this box to your desired resolution. Try and keep it divisible by 16. Once you've input your settings here, we're not actually going to run any cells for a while. We're going to actually do a batch run on all of these once we've put in everything. So we move down to the video input settings. So this is your input video path. So I've saved my input video, which is this, onto my Google Drive. So simply go to this folder here, go to Drive, My Drive. I've made a folder called Video and I've just put it in there, and it is Girl Dance. If you navigate over to these three dots here and then go to Copy Path, and we simply just replace the default one and Control V to paste our new path. Underneath, we've got Extract M Frame. This means it's going to diffuse every single frame in our animation. Now, we don't necessarily want that if we've got a long video, because that's going to take a long time. If you increase this to 2, that means it's going to diffuse every other frame, which technically reduces the diffusion time by 50%. This is actually quite a short input video, so I'm just going to let it diffuse every frame. But if it's taking too long, you can change this to 2 and it shouldn't make a huge impact on your animation. So we come down to video masking. I use this a lot in my videos to make the background consistent and quite stable. I'm going to be using the mask source as my input video, and also you need to extract the background mask. For this tutorial, I'm just going to put my input video as the mask video path. Now you can actually mask and add another video into this to be in the background. I'm just going to use my video as a mask as well for the background. And then we come down to define SDK functions. We need to change the load to GPU, and underneath the model path, we need to change it to the model that we want to use. So this is the checkpoint model. So you can grab checkpoints from Civit AI or Hugging Face. I've actually already got a checkpoint saved to my Google Drive. So I'm just going to go back to my Google Drive and go to a folder I made called checkpoints, and I'm going to use deliberate. So three dots, copy path, and then replace the default setting. Slightly further down, we have control nets models directory here. We want to change that to a path on our Google Drive. So you can simply just make a folder on your Google Drive and call it control net, and go to the three dots, copy path, and just delete the default and control V and paste that new path to your Google Drive. This is going to save all the control nets onto your Google Drive so we can use them on this notebook. Further down, we have the tiled vay section. So you will only need to check use tiled vay if you're getting CUDA out of memory issues. If you get that problem when you're running your diffusion on cell number 4, come back and check this box, rerun, and then diffuse again, and that should help your CUDA out of memory issue. Okay, so we are now going to head down towards the GUI section. And when you're here, you'll see this reference control net. Just select this cell by clicking on it and it should highlight it. And the reason why we want to do that is because we want to run all the cells before this. So make sure that's selected and come up to runtime on your top horizontal toolbar and then select run before. Now this is going to start running all these cells above this. So this is going to take about 5 to 10 minutes, and you will get a green tick for every cell that has successfully completed. I'm going to come back down to GUI and I'll see you in a second. We are back and all our cells have run successfully. We are in the GUI section and you will notice we have this new settings dialog here. So at the top we can select our settings difficulty. By default it's set at Hey Not Too Rough, but you can switch between the difficulties here. Once you've changed it, remember to run the cell so you can initiate those new settings. We've got this default settings path, which is really handy for loading in predefined settings. I've saved a text file in the description for you guys to use for this tutorial. Just remember you need to manually change the path names. You can actually just edit it in Notepad, resave it and upload it. And to load it in, you just go to your folders. I've saved mine in settings, copy path, and then I'm just going to simply then paste that text file into this default settings path here. You want to make sure that load default settings is checked, because that means it's going to override everything in this settings dialog with what's in this text file here. What will happen if we run this cell, you will see all those settings change and it's going to be reading that text file. So if we come up to the prompt, and yes, it's got my prompt in here. If you want to change any of the prompts in these box, just uncheck this box and then we can take that as a base and edit from there. So I suggest you might want to do that. I'm going to fly through these settings because I've saved them down in my description as a text file. I've simplified the prompt here because sometimes it's easier for the AI to understand what you want to do if you simplify it and break it down. We're just going to stop right there. If you want your stone statue to be a white marble stone statue, we'll simply just type that prompt in here and your animation will look like this. Got your step schedule. Style strength is at 0.7. If you're finding stylization is too strong and it's not giving you coherent images, bump this down to 0.6, and the opposite as well. If you're finding it's not giving you enough stylization, bump it up to 0.8, try running it again. The CFG scale is your prompt guidance. So 1 means there's no prompt guidance on your input video, which you don't want. Medium is round about 7. 15 is fully listening to your prompt. We go to the control net tab and I'm using Canny. You just check these boxes to what control net models you want to use. You can change the weight of these models as well in these input boxes. And then we go to the warp tab. Your flow blend is your input video blending with the next frame stylization. So if you're finding it's over stylized, bring this down to 0.7. Again, small adjustments, then run and see how it goes. I'm gonna jump into the mask tab here. So you can check the use background mask, and you can actually change the color or an image or original video. And you can change the color here. If you type in pink, blue, or red, it understands that and it will change it to that color. If we come back to the diffusion tab and scroll down the page, and you've got your seed, so you can input your seed here and check fix seed. You don't actually have to have that on. We are pretty much ready to render diffusion, but I want to show you one last thing. You can actually insert Loras into your prompt, and it's super easy. Loras are great for adding certain elements to your animation. So for instance, this one's energy veins, you can add different clothing or change the character completely just by using Lora. Head over to Civit AI and download the Lora you want to use. Once you have downloaded that Loras file, just head to your Google Drive, go to your models folder, Loras, and just save it in here. You can save multiple Loras in this folder. Once you've saved the Lora, just grab the tag from Civit AI just by going like this, and we simply then paste that into our prompt. So I've got a trigger word as well as the tag. You can change the weighting of the Lora as well. And once we finish, we just rerun that GUI section, and then we come down. We have the user reference section. So do we want to emphasize on the control nets or more the prompt, or we can have a balanced approach. So we're going a balanced approach. And then the last section is number 4, which is diffuse. We simply just run this cell. As your animation progresses, you'll see a preview frame here. So these frames happen ever so often, so you can see if there are any errors. If there are errors in your animation or things that you'd like to fix, you simply just click on this stop button to stop the diffusion, and then you can come up to your GUI section again and change any of these settings. Once you have completed the run of your animation, your frames will be saved to your Google Drive. So we can come down to number 5, which is create a video, and you can run this cell and it'll simply create you a video from the frames it diffused in this cell above. Now you might be wondering where all these frames and videos have gone to, and they've actually saved to your Google Drive. So if you come back over to your Google Drive, Warp Fusion has created you a folder structure. You go to the top hierarchy and go to AI, stable Warp Fusion, images underscore out, and then you will see the batch name for your folder that you created. If you go into there, and this is where your video will live. You've got your settings. Remember the text files. It will generate you that every time you run a diffusion, and all your lovely frames, which you can then bring into post-production DaVinci Resolve, After Effects. I'm in the edit tab in DaVinci Resolve, and I'm going to simply just drag those frames in, go to the fusion tab, click on the first node and shift spacebar, and from here choose deflicker, and then deflicker settings up here. From the drop down, select fluoro light, I think that's what it's called, and then select the deflicker node, and then control C and control V and paste that. That will reduce down the flickering of the animation. So from here I'm going to go to deliver and export my videos, and just checking all the settings are good there, and I'm going to click on add to render queue, and then I'm going to render all. That's going to render out those frames and put them into a .mov file. Now we're going on to the next stage, which is upscaling our video. So the industry standard for upscaling videos with AI seems to be Topaz Lab. However, that comes with a really expensive price tag, which is this, and maybe not everybody can afford it or wants to pay that much money for maybe a hobby or just playing around with AI. I've been doing some research on alternative programs to use, and I found Pixar. And the reason I like this program so much is because it's browser-based, which means I don't have to install anything onto my computer. I can get to this via my phone, my iPad, my computer, and it's super easy to use. So this is a pay-as-you-go service. So you don't have to pay one lump sum for a piece of software. You just use it when you need it. There's no contract, and it's really easy to use. So I simply drag and drop my video into their browser, and it uploads. Now, what's great about this? Whilst it's uploading, I can go away and work on my computer, or just shut this down, and it's still uploading. That has now finished uploading my video, so I'm just going to click on it, and then click on my video. Now, you can see here where it's zoomed in, it's pretty ugly. What we want to do is increase the size of the video and make it a bit sharper. So we come down to process here. As you can see, there are quick factory settings, so you don't actually need to dive into any of the settings. I'm actually just going to go to filters for this one and go to the denoising drop down. I'm going to choose Pixop Denoiser, then I'm going to come down to scaler and I'm going to choose Pixop Deep Restoration 2. And then I'm going to come to the resolution. I'm going to upscale it to 4K. I'm now going to click on the process button, which will take me to the costing. So it's going to cost 92 cents to upscale this video. Like I said before, it's pay as you go, which is very useful if you're just doing one-off projects. So I'm going to click on confirm. Here it also gives me the option to create a preset for this video. Now the video is processing and I'll come back and show you a comparison. My video has finished processing. If we check the original here and then check the processed one, we can then click on this compare button. This is where we can see a difference. So this is a frame from the original footage. I just drag over. You can see the upscale version. Thought I'd show you another comparison and move my big head out the way. You can see there on the left is the original and then on the right is my upscaled. I'll post the comparison video on my website as well so you can have a look. And as usual, please, please, please tag me in your social media posts on Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, whatever you use, because I love to see what you guys are creating. Thank you so much. I'm going to be putting a written version of this tutorial onto my website, which is promptmuse.com. A massive shout out to everybody who supports this channel and shares this channel and subscribes this channel. Thank you so much. And if you haven't, please hit that subscribe button and that thumbs up button. That would be awesome. I'm really excited to see what you guys create. Thank you so much, guys, and keep on prompting, and that will do it. Bye bye.